Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if Julio kind of signed a deal with Zoom to get that rolling. So Shannon,
I know. I wonder what's going to happen with that. That was kind of wild.
Yeah. What did you think of that? Do you think he knew?
I don't know. I'm pretty sure like Shannon should have told him. So I think Shannon would have told him. So I think he knew, but I don't know. I don't know either. I don't know.
Yeah, it's just a weird. You'd hope so.
You hope Shannon would do that.
Because it's not like it's a bad look because it blew up. The thing is, like, he's been there so long, they love him in Atlanta. So
yeah,
it's a bad look. Might as well get rolling on here. All right, I want to welcome on my next guest. We have a very special guest. We've got Raiders defensive lineman Solomon Thomas. Solomon, is everything going for you?
It's going great, Zach. You know, I really appreciate you having me on the show. Super happy to be here. Let's get into it.
I absolutely appreciate it. First off, how's your knee?
Knee's doing great. You know, I've been about 7.5 months out of surgery right now. And, you know, I've been honestly limited, but really full participating in OTAs right now, you know, getting all the reps, going hard. You know, I've been very blessed in my rehab. You know, I have a great treatment team. You know, I did most of my rehab in Orange County at a place called Telus Method. And with a guy named Rex Butler, and I use a guy named Scott Herrera. They have the true biomechanical like anatomy to how everything's supposed to work. It's unconventional stuff called ODOA, myofascial stretching, pumping. But the work that they've done has really advanced me and have me confident, and my knee's ready, and I'm feeling great. I'm on the field, not hesitant, being decisive, being fast, explosive. You know, stronger than I've ever been, you know, and I'm feeling great. I'm really excited for this year.
How's the humidity out there? Is it like unreal? What is it like?
Humidity is not the problem. It's a dry heat. I'm telling you, my first day out here, my lips busted open in about 3 hours. I was like, what? I was like, and I'm like, so if I don't apply chapstick daily, my lips will break. It's wild.
That's what it is. I've never been to Vegas. I know they got the strip and then it's just...
Everything.
I'm just rewatching Breaking Bad, and I'm like, so this is what Vegas is like. That's one. And then, so what was last season like for you? Obviously, you got hurt in game two. How was that, especially with the pandemic going on? What was the whole process like?
Man, it was really tough. You know, it was a hard year for me. Health wise, it was a new year for me. I had never had any surgeries before 2020. 2020, I had 4 surgeries, 3 of them being major surgeries. So I was with my treatment guys a lot, my team a lot. During the season, it was extremely tough, you know, to watch the guys. You know, I wanted to be there. I asserted myself as a leader at the Niners. I was playing the best football I've ever played in my life. I was ready to have a breakout season and help the team win. And I couldn't be around the guys. I couldn't do what I worked all offseason doing, rehab, 2 surgeries all offseason to do this and just to be healthy for about a few weeks to tear my ACL. So it was a really hard year for me mentally and physically, but, you know, I learned a lot about myself. You know, I wouldn't have changed it. You know, if I do 2020 over again, you know, crazy to say I'd still have the same 4 surgeries because what I've learned about my body, what I've learned about my mind has truly made me who I am today. You know, the adversity I've been put through, you know, I learned about myself. I learned how to love myself. I learned who I am as a human. I really had to search deep about, you know, certain things, learned my own mental health routine and habits I need to result to when I feel a certain way, and learned how much I love football, how much the game means to me. Fell in love with the game like I'm a fourth grader, like playing football in my front yard. So it was a long year, but, you know, I made it through it, and I'm seeing, you know, broader pictures now and feeling great on the field, back with the team. Couldn't feel better. So, yeah, I'm excited.
That's awesome. And then obviously, since you have a little bit more added free time in your recovery, is that what kind of propelled you to start the Defensive Line Foundation to kind of get that framework moving to where we are today?
Definitely. You know, I had more time to work on it with my parents and my cousin Ray. You know, I mean, we've been working on it for a couple of years now, but we finally got it launched, you know, last week. But, you know, I definitely was able to be on more meetings, get more input, you know, put more work in. And that was just fun. You know, it's fun to be part of the process. It was fun, you know, to really like do the work that's going to help save lives and change lives. And, you know, that's what's just motivating about this, and to, you know, connect with certain mental health professionals and learn from them and understand more about it and how real this stuff is and how much more we have to go, really, really just kind of was motivating to me and just really inspiring.
Yeah. So I want to ask you a few questions about your career. I saw one thing I did not know before about an hour ago. I didn't know you spent some time growing up in Australia.
Yes, sir. Yeah. I'm an Aussie at heart. I really am. And so I grew up in, I spent year 2 through 7.5 in Australia. And we used to go back every like 1 to 3 years. And, you know, after actually when I got drafted, you know, I did a media tour in Australia because they kind of accepted me as like their long lost son, because it was like, you know, an Aussie, like a part-time Aussie playing in the NFL, you know. So, you know, I feel like a little adopted by Australia. You know, I definitely, it's my favorite vacation spot. It's a warm spot of my heart. One of my favorite places on this earth. So, yeah, definitely a huge Aussie at heart. Yeah, and I love Vegemite, and most people don't love Vegemite. So,
what is Vegemite for me and everybody else? There's no idea what it is.
Vegemite's like a black jam. It's black. It doesn't look good. It's very bitter. Has a little like sour taste, but if you put like get some toast, put some butter on it, some Vegemite.
And then one thing, everybody, anytime you think Australia, people think kangaroos. I heard all the animals there are like 3 times the normal size, and it's kind of like frightening. Is that true?
I mean, my mom used to send me to kill black widows with my shoes when I was like 3 years old, because I was just a daredevil and a little Tasmanian devil too. And I was just full of energy. She's like, go kill this spider, whatever. But I mean, yeah, there's a lot of animals. Like you'll see koalas all like, I mean, kangaroos are awesome. Like, I mean, I remember wallabies. They're so cute. And I don't know, I mean, I love the animals down there and the wildlife. You go to like natural parks and just see and interact. And so it's pretty cool. Yeah.
That's awesome. And then I want to ask you, so obviously you go to Stanford. What was it like playing for David Shaw? And do you think he's ever going to come to the NFL?
I love Stanford. You know, we just had like a little Stanford reunion with a football team a couple weekends ago in Arizona. And just there's no other locker room in the world like Stanford's locker room. The connection we have, the bond we have, and we can truly give that credit to, you know, our strength coach, Coach Turley. He really got us to buy in and love each other. And it was like memories that, you know, we'll have forever. Like it was truly, Stanford was, you know, it wasn't the easiest. It was tough. You know, it was a grind, but we pushed each other through it. We had each other's back. Like the locker room was truly a family, like even more than high school. So it was just so pure, so real, and memories I'll have forever. And then Coach Shaw was amazing. I mean, just a coach who cares for you as an intellect and a human. You don't have that rarely. And he really cared for us in that way. And I think that's special. And I don't know. He could go to the NFL if he wanted to easily. He is that good of a coach and brilliant mind, you know, amazing human being, just incredible. But I think he's so special at Stanford. I think, you know, his dad coaching there, him coaching there, you know, him playing there, like he has such a special place and special touch there. I think he's a perfect coach for Stanford.
Do you think Pac-12 football is on its way back?
I hope so. I mean, you know, those years where I was there when we were on top and the years before I got there, you know, I want that back because I'm tired of all this SEC talk, Big 12, Big 10 talk. You know, the real football is in the pack.
And then your draft process, what was that like? What was that whole situation like for you?
You know, it was really cool. I mean, it was just, I mean, like stuff I dreamed of. Like I never really knew or thought I was going to be on stage at the NFL draft, you know, being the third pick. You know, it was just stuff I saw on TV that I dreamed of. And I was like, Dad, look at this. Mom, look at this. Like I want to be there someday. And I got there. And like, sometimes I have to look back and be like, dang, I really lived that. Because during the time you take it for granted, because you're going through it, you're enjoying it, you're young. But I look back and I was like, damn, like I actually did that. That's pretty cool. So it was an unbelievable experience. You know, it was in Philadelphia, really cool city. We had a great time and it was a lot of fun.
Did the Eagles fans boo every pick or just the Giants, every Cowboys, and Washington?
Yeah, every pick but the Eagles. Yeah, I was definitely
probably am Eagles. Yeah, their fans are.
Well, no, they got Derek Barnett that year, and he was a great player. He's a great player. So yeah. I don't think about that. He's my
Eagles
boy.
Fan. Don't get me started on Eagles fans. And then so did you think San Fran was looking at you? Do you have any idea?
We thought there was no chance at all because they drafted Eric Armstead 2 years before, then DeForest Buckner, and we were like, there's no way. Didn't have any draft meetings with them, no contact. And we were like, all right, there's no way. And so we thought after the Bears didn't pick me at 2, we thought, okay, well, our next chance is probably 7 with the Chargers or something like that. So we thought we were going to be on the board for a little bit.
That's unbelievable. And then, so what was that moment like, the surreal moment when they call your name, number 3 pick in the NFL draft?
I was going crazy. My heart was beating so fast. Like if you watch a call again, like on YouTube or something, like you can just hear it in my voice. Like my voice is like shaky. I'm like, I just going crazy. My sister's tugging my arm. Mom and dad are all over me. Truly a magical experience.
Do you wish Goodell had brought his chair then so you could have sit on it? Because you get that experience going through with the chair?
I'm good. I liked a little hug or whatever. That was fine.
And you would have had Kings of Leon playing for 4 hours straight, which was wild to me. I don't know if you saw that. They were just taking requests at one. I wasn't there, but I'm just watching. Yeah, they were there in the background. I'm like, this is like a double bar mitzvah for them. I don't know what's going on with that, but it was unbelievable. And then so I want to ask you, so one of your members of your draft class, George Kittle, is quite a character. Do you have any interesting, funny stories about him from your time in San Fran?
I love George. You know, George is just awesome. You know, he's George every day. George hasn't changed since rookie year, coming in, WWE guy, big energy guy, just like loving life. Just he is who he is. And trying to think of any funny stories. I mean, no, George, you always just get George. Like, you see George, like, he's always him. He's truly an incredible human being, incredible player. And I really love him and his family.
Who's the toughest offensive lineman to get through in the NFL?
I've gone through some tough guys. Trent Williams is unbelievable. Joe Staley, unbelievable. I mean, Tyron Smith, you know, all those guys, you know, they're the best of the best. And then another guy, the guy who welcomed me to the NFL was Trent Brown. I mean, this guy's 6'7", 380. I'm like, oh my gosh. Like, you've never had my chest punched like that before. Yeah, he definitely, those guys are the best of the best.
And then obviously your foundation is called the defensive line. So I want to ask you, who has the best defensive line in the NFL?
The best defensive line in the NFL. You know, I'm betting on my own team, you know, the Raiders. You know, we have Yannick Ngakoue, Clelin Ferrell, Max Crosby, Quentin Jefferson, Darius Filon. You know, I'm in there. You know, you got Kendall Vickers. You know, who else am I missing? Carl Nasbitt. You know, we got a young D-line who's hungry and just ready to get after it. We got Jonathan Hankins, you know, a freak, an underrated freak. Like, you know, I'm excited for this team. We're hungry. And, you know, I'm excited to get after it. And I can't wait to play with these guys and put it all to work and just have that unity and rush together and really disrupt this league.
Is Lamar Houston still there? Lamar Houston? He's been gone for a while. Damn, I thought he was on the Raiders. I thought he was just kind of sticking around waiting for his opportunity. So what sold you on going to the Raiders after your options declined in San Fran?
You know, they had a D-line coach who I've always wanted to play for. Coach Marinelli is someone I've looked up to since I got in the league. Loved the way he played his guys in Dallas. Loved the way he played his guys in Tampa Bay back in when they won the Super Bowl in 2002. You know, he's one hell of a coach, hell of a person. And I just believe, like, you know, the way he plays his guys is how I should play the game. Like, they're fast, get off the ball, disruptive, up the field. And that's how I need to play. I'm a quick, undersized, explosive D-tackle. Like, I need that. And so just playing for him in the same system that I was playing with the Niners, Gus Bradley system, you know, it was a perfect fit. And, you know, they needed me. They wanted me. They showed that they wanted me. And I was like, this is where I want to be. This is perfect for me. Like, you know, I have no hard feelings towards my time in San Fran. I love them. They're forever in my heart, but this is what was better for me and my career. And I had to go with them.
Did Gruden call you up? It's like, Hey, we wanted to get you over here. It was a horrible impression.
Yeah, I had to call with Gruden. Yeah. No, he was a man. His energy sold me too. You know, I every day playing for a guy like that is fun. You know, he makes the game fun. He has that love in his heart. You can tell he loves the game. So it's fun.
Does Howie Long involved with you guys at all? Kind of reach out because it's like Raiders defensive line legend.
You know, I haven't met Howie or heard from him yet, but I don't know how involved he is. But you know, he's a legend, Hall of Famer. Both his sons were great players in the league. You know, I respect all the work that Chris does. You know, I'm a big fan of Chris. You know, the way he played and what he does in the football community, and I listen to his podcast every now and then. So, you know, big fan of him and his family.
It's awesome. Does the foundation, do you guys have any events on the horizon coming up as maybe things start to reopen?
No. So we have our first pilot program happening June 15th, you know, working with Coppell ISD and doing our first program work with them. But we just launched last week, you know, the defensive line. You know, our mission is, you know, to end the epidemic of youth suicide, especially for those of color, by transforming the way we connect and communicate about mental health. You know, we're having these programs where we're going to put in schools, businesses, you know, sports programs, whatever it is, to make sure that these mentors of youth, of all youth, you know, make sure that they can be equipped with the language to talk about mental health, so they can tell them where to go for resources, so they can talk about their problems, so they can be vulnerable, so they can have, you know, resources for them and just see like when, you know, one is struggling and have, can identify that. We're going to help with suicide prevention programs in schools and just create a better community of mental health. So people understand the science of it. People understand the seriousness of it. People understand the disease that mental health can be, just so like we can make a healthier life and normalize being human and normalize, you know, making it okay to not be okay, normalize empathy. You know, that is our goal. And that's what we're going to do every day to make sure we can change and save lives. You know, we're super excited to start our work and super excited to do more. And you know, you can check us out at thedefensiveline.org or at the Defensive Line Instagram. You know, so I'll, we'll have more posts there and as well as upcoming events. So yeah.
Awesome. Awesome, man. Well, you guys are doing an amazing job. Can't wait to see what work you guys keep doing in the future, but it's been a pleasure. So I do appreciate you taking the time to chat for a few minutes.
Thank you, Zach. I appreciate it, man.